found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, and I shall read verses 31 through 35. Jesus said to his disciples, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he'll rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet, because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "If anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last and the servant of all." The shareholders of a major Fortune 500 company decided that it was time for their company to undergo a major shakeup. So they hired a new CEO who was determined to rid the company of all slackers. On visiting the facility, he entered a hall that was full of workers, and he noticed one man was leaning against the wall. Determined to show the workers that he meant business, he approached this man who was leaning against the wall and said, "How much money do you earn in a week?" And the man replied, "I earn 300 a week." "Why do you ask this question?" And the CEO pulled out his checkbook. He wrote out a check in the amount of $1,200. And he said, "Here is your pay for 4 weeks. Get out of this place and don't come back." Then he asked the foreman what type of work was assigned to that slacker. And the foreman said, "He was the pizza delivery man from Domino's." You know, we make mistakes and blunders. Employers and CEOs also make mistakes and blunders because they act on information that is either incomplete or completely wrong. Whether we are employers or employees, it's wise not to make a decision or not to act on a decision unless we have gathered all the pertinent information, unless we're sure that the information we have is correct and complete. Now, when we go to our scripture reading for this for today, we find that midway through his earthly ministry, Jesus told his disciples what would happen to him in Jerusalem. He said he would be betrayed, arrested, killed, but he would be resurrected on the third day. The scripture says the disciples could not understand what Jesus had said, because it didn't make sense to them. It didn't fit their view of the Messiah. They, like all other Jews of their time, thought the Messiah would never be killed or could not be killed. So Jesus' statement did not make sense to them. They did not understand it, and they did not ask Jesus for clarifications. As Jesus and disciples proceeded traveling toward the city of Capernaum, which is near the Sea of Galilee, Jesus was walking in front of the disciples, like the good shepherd leading the sheep. And the disciples who were walking behind Jesus were arguing among themselves as they traveled along the road. They were arguing about who would be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. They were puffed up with selfish ambition, and jockeyed for the highest position. I can imagine their argument or conversation went like this. I believe Peter was the first to speak up because he always was the first to speak up. And Peter said, I'll have the greatest place in the kingdom of heaven because I am the most daring among you. You remember, I was the one who jumped into the stormy sea and walked on the water when Jesus bid me to come to him. All of you stayed in the boat. I'm the most daring, so I deserve to have the highest position in the kingdom of heaven. Then Andrew spoke up. You know, Andrew was Peter's brother. And Andrew said, I'll have the highest place in the kingdom of heaven because I was the first person to become a disciple of Jesus. And by the way, Peter, I was the one who introduced you to Jesus. If it were not for me, you might not have become a disciple of Jesus. And Matthew argued by saying he deserved to have the highest position because he knew how to keep records. He was a tax collector before becoming a disciple of Christ. And he said, I kept the tax rolls very neatly, very correctly, and I knew who owed how much. So when it comes to management, I have the best skills. Then John spoke out and he said, I deserve to have the highest place because I am Jesus' dearest friend. Jesus is closest to me than to any of you. And Judas said, I deserve the highest place because Jesus entrusted me with all the financial affairs. I am the most trustworthy. Well, all the time they were traveling along the road towards the city of Capernaum, they kept arguing among themselves, and Jesus heard every word of their argument, but didn't say anything. Upon reaching the city of Capernaum, they settled in a house. We don't know whose house it was. The gospel record doesn't mention. But many Bible commentators assume it was Peter's house because whenever Jesus visited the city of Capernaum, he stayed at Peter's house. So it's not a far-fetched idea to believe that the house they entered was Peter's house. So when they were inside the house and settled down, Jesus asked the disciples a question. What were you arguing about while traveling along the road? And the disciples remained silent. No one wanted to answer that penetrating question. Then Jesus said, he who wants to be first in the kingdom of heaven must be the servant of all. Richard Foster, an American theologian, has written a book entitled The Celebration of Discipline. And in this book, he explains the difference between self-righteousness and self-righteous service and true service. By the way, self-righteous service is self-seeking service. So in other words, he explains the difference between unselfish service and selfish service. And he points out 8 differences that I would like to go over them one by one. First, he says, selfish service or self-righteous service is prompted by human effort because the donors spend a great deal of time on calculating whom to help. They don't want to help anyone. So they study sociological charts and the results of surveys to find out whom to help. whereas unselfish service is prompted by the Holy Spirit. Second, self-seeking service is concerned with results. The selfish donors want to see how people will respond, whereas unselfish service is not concerned with the results. Third, selfish service, people who are self-seekers, pick and choose to help those needy people who are connected with the most powerful and influential persons in society. In other words, they don't help anyone, they want to help, they target the people whom they want to help. And they choose to help only those who are connected, who have some connection with the political and social elite. Why? Because they want a good payoff. They want to make sure that their investment will give them a good payoff. Whereas true service, unselfish servants serve anyone who is in need. Fourth, self-righteous service gets the attention, want to get the attention of the press. Selfish people who want to help others do so only when the press is present. In fact, they are delighted when their work is highlighted in the newspapers. True service is not concerned with publicity. Fifth, self-seekers look for external rewards. They want to be applauded and praised, and the true servants expect no earthly rewards. Six, self-seekers are affected by their moods and whims. If the donor had a bad day, well, he is not in a disposition to help anyone that day. Whereas true servants are not limited by circumstances. And seventh, self-seekers, when they want to serve others, they their help is temporary, or they will render help only when it serves their interests and promotes their reputation. So if their reputation is not being promoted, if their self-interests are not served, then they won't render help to anyone. For the true servants of Christ, serving others is a lifestyle. And the last one, number eight, which Richard Foster mentions, is that self-righteous service fractures communities. How do they fracture communities? Because whenever they have people, they manipulate them and put them in their debt. Whereas the true servants of Christ build communities, they don't fracture communities. So these are the eight differences that Richard Foster mentions between self-righteous service and true service. Now Jesus invites us to be servants of all. He says, he wants to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, must be the servant of all. So we have to serve people despite any inconvenience. Conductor Leonard Bernstein was once asked which was the most difficult instrument to play in an orchestra. And without hesitation, he said, second fiddle. Without second fiddle, we can't have harmony. Now, most people don't want to play second fiddle. Serving is giving ourselves to others for the benefit of others. And our greatest example is Jesus Christ, of whom it said, he did not come to be served, he came to serve. When Jesus gathered the disciples around the Last Supper table, they were still troubled over who would be the greatest in the kingdom. And you know, whenever there's trouble over who would be the greatest, there's also trouble over who would be the least. We know that we are not the most perfect people. We know we are not the best people, but we also don't want to be the least. No one wants to be the least. No one wants to be the tail or at the end of the line. So when they sat around that Last Supper table, the disciples were aware of the fact that someone had to wash the other's feet. Someone had to perform the role of a servant, and none of them was willing to perform the role of a servant. So they were shocked when Jesus got up and he tied a towel around his waist and started washing the disciples' feet that were covered with a thick layer of dust. In the Gospel of John, chapter 13, verses 12 to 17, Jesus asked the disciples, do you know what I did to you? This was after washing their feet. He said, did you know what I did for you? You called me Lord and Master, and you are right. If I, your Lord and Master, condescended to wash your feet, then you must do likewise. You should also wash each other's feet. I left for you an example so that you do as I did to you. So Jesus left for us an example in humble service. He left for us an example in unselfish service, and we have to emulate his example, and we should not be selective in whom to help. Anyone who needs help deserves to be helped, regardless of his social standing. In Greek mythology, it is told that two of the gods, Zeus and Hermes, decided to visit the earth for a short period of time, disguised as slaves. They wore the rags of slaves, and they wanted to evaluate the level of the people's devotion to their gods. So as they walked the streets of the cities, dressed as slaves, nobody paid attention to them. But then, when they threw off their rags and revealed their true identity, they received the devotion of people. Now, Jesus came to this world in the form of a servant. He came not to disguise God, but to reveal to us who God is. On the day of final reckoning, or at the day of judgment, Jesus would turn to some people and tell them, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me a drink. When I was a stranger, you took me in. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you cared for me. And when I was in prison, you visited me. And the saved would be astonished because they would not be able to recall ever seeing Jesus in those conditions, and they could not remember rendering such help to Jesus. And then he'd tell them, whatever service you rendered to the least of my brethren, you rendered it unto me. So the best way to express our love for Christ is to help people. Marion Kazell was a princess born in Hungary. Her parents sent her to Vienna to study philosophy, but she became an actress. And while in Vienna, she fell in love with a Swedish medical student named Otto Peringer. And they got married. When her husband finished medical school, they immigrated to the States and settled in Hollywood. Otto Peringer started dabbling with the movies. And after a short time, he gave up his medical practice and he decided to become a movie director. His wife, Marion Kazell, used her charm, wit, and intelligence and became a socialite hostess. But she could not handle the fast life. Pretty soon she became addicted to alcohol and drugs and had several affairs. Finally, Otto divorced her. Her husband divorced her and she attempted suicide. Fortunately, she failed. Then she decided to return to Vienna. In Vienna, she met Dr. Albert Schweitzer. You must have heard about Albert Schweitzer. He was a multi-talented Christian. He was a musician, a theologian, a missionary, a philosopher. He was in Vienna giving organ recitals to raise money for his mission hospital in West Africa. And this Hungarian princess met him in Vienna and volunteered to work as an assistant nurse at his hospital. Schweitzer, first of all, was reluctant to accept her offer because he thought, well, she's a princess born in the lap of luxury. How could she survive in West Africa where the conditions were very primitive? But she insisted, and he finally consented. She went there and served for 20 years, living under the most primitive conditions. Then, when she wrote her autobiography, she said, "When I lived only to gratify my selfish pleasures, I almost lost my life. But when I devoted my life to serve others, I found joy and fulfillment." There you have it. Steve Jobs, I know you know him, the founder of Apple Computers, one day decided to recruit John Sculley, who was the president of Pepsi soft drink company. Jobs realized this fellow had a special managerial talent and he wanted to recruit him. And when he found that John Sculley was hesitant to accept the offer, Steve Jobs said, "Do you want to spend the rest of your life selling sugared water Or do you want to have a chance to change the world? In James chapter 1, verse 27, true religion is defined. The Apostle John defines true religion for us and says, true religion is helping the widows and the orphans in their affliction. And if we do that, we will have a tremendous impact on this world. In Paris, there are statues, or there are statues erected for different men, but I want to call your attention to two. One is the statue of King Louis XIV. King Louis XIV believed in receiving the service of his countrymen. He believed all Frenchmen had to serve him. He said, I'm the state. He didn't care for the members of parliament, for the members of the cabinet. His word was, though he ruled France single-handed, I am the state. And he believed that all Frenchmen were obligated to serve him. So there is a statue of him erected in Paris, wearing a crown and holding a sword. Several blocks down the same street, there's another statue erected to another Louis, but this one is Louis Pasteur, a scientist. This fellow was a devoted Christian. He spent his lifetime to help to prevent people from dying by contracting infections. So he devised the pasteurization process. Now, thanks to him, we drink pasteurized milk, pasteurized orange juice, and are protected from contracting infections. So the statue of Louis Pasteur doesn't have a crown, he doesn't bear a sword, but underneath his statue is written his name, and underneath his name, a servant of God and humanity. What a great summation of a person's life. May we also be known as servants of God and servants of humanity.